Thank you for joining us today. We hope that you receive a blessing from this program. We hope that you will join us in person this Sunday at 9:30 for Sunday school and 10:35 for the service. We promise you will receive a warm welcome. For more information or to watch our services live, please go to gpindy.net. Now, let's join the service.
Power in the blood.
Sing now.
Would you be free from your burden? Sing. There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. Would your evil and victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, wonder-working power.
Take a look to your left or your right on the wall and on the screen. Who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth, unto the knowledge of truth, 1 Timothy 2:4. Just think about it. Did you talk to anybody about the Lord last week? Will you talk to somebody about the Lord this week? You know, that's the whole thing. If we, each one of us, would purpose in our hearts to talk to somebody about the Lord, it would be amazing how many people would come to the knowledge of the truth, because you get them here. And you know, people are searching right now. It's just like that little video said, this, you know, the world's hurting right now. And we need you to reach the lost, and along with the staff, along with everybody else, we need to reach the lost. We really do. There's a couple of things. Some people said, how do I get online? I had a couple of calls this week. How do I get online and give? If you go to our website, it's www.gpindy.net. Right up in the top right-hand corner, there's a little blue sign that says give. If you click that give, go to the next slide. If you click that, this it'll go to this page, and it'll just say give across the top, and then the next slide tells you how you can. If you click each, any one of those individually, right under the word online, if you click the little sentence under there, it'll take you right to a page. You can text it. It's very easily. All you do is text the word give, and then Enter that number, 855-997-1232, and basically it takes you to a screen. Choose Grace Point Church, set up your profile, and from then on, you can give just like that. Very simple. And we just want to thank you for giving and giving to the Lord, because, you know, it's because of you that we are here today. And it's because of the Lord, obviously, ultimately, but he chose to, through you, give of financially so that we can continue this work. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you that we have the opportunity to serve you in this way. Thank you for the gifts of our people. I pray that you'd bless the music program now. May it prepare hearts for the message. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Makes no difference what the problem.
I can go to God in prayer.
For I have this blessed assurance.
I can go to God in prayer.
He will take your sin and sorrow.
Turn it into life. I can call him.
Guadalupe are coming to sing a great song called Thank You, Lord, for the Trials That Come My Way.
Thank you, Lord. And thank you, Lord, patience to trials bring in that process of growing. I can learn to care, but it goes against the way I am to put my human nature down and let the spirit take control of all I do. 'Cause when those trials come, my human nature shouts at things to do, and God's love from thing can be easily ignored. I thank you, Lord, for the trials that come my way. Feel inside that you're there to help lead and guide me away from. When those trials come, my human nature shouts the things to do, and God's love prompting can be easily ignored. I thank you, Lord.
I thank you, Lord,
for the victory that growing
through that growing dreams.
Life is so worthwhile, and I thank you, Lord.
I thank you, Lord.
That's when everything put in place. Out in front, I can see your face, and it's there you belong. But it goes again. So give me strength to do thy holy will, my
Lord. Ashamed of what I've done, what I've become. These hands are dirty. I dare not lift them up to the Holy One.
You plead my cause, you overcome.
afraid I've let you down. Inside I doubt that you could love me. But in your eyes there's only grace now.
Thank you. for so long I had searched for life's meaning, enslaved by this world and my greed. Then the door of my prison, it was opened by love. The ransom was paid and I was free.
I'm free from the fear of tomorrow. I'm free from the guilt of the past. For I've traded my shackles for a glorious home. I'm free. From the guilt that I carry, from this dull, empty life, I'm set free. For when I met Jesus, He made me complete. He forgot the foolish one I used to be. I'm free from the fears of tomorrow. I'm free from the guilt of the past. Oh, I've traded my shackles for a glorious soul. I'm free, praise the Lord, free.
Songs. I'd like for you to turn your Bibles to Psalm 46. Psalm 46. I had another message already, and yesterday afternoon I decided I didn't want to give it, and it was about our country, government, everything going on, and I just didn't feel there was enough of the Lord involved in it. So I put it aside, and I'll rework it for later. But Carol was telling me that when Billy Graham was being honored there, when all the dignitaries were at his place, he says, "Too much Billy Graham, not enough Jesus." And I felt that's what was going on myself. And so I wanted to just reach back, take an old sermon, redo it, and just to try to encourage you. God is always faithful is the title of my message. God is always faithful. Before I get there, though, one day, three men were hiking and unexpectedly came upon a large, raging, violent river. They needed to get to the other side but had no idea how to do so. The first man prayed to God, saying, "Please, God, give me the strength to cross the river." Poof! God gave him big arms and strong legs, and he was able to swim across the river in about 2 hours and almost drowned a couple of times. Saying this, the second man, he was saying, "Please, God, give me the strength and the tools to cross this river." Poof! God gave him a rowboat, and he was able to row across the river in about an hour after almost capsizing multiple times. The third man had seen how this worked. So he noticed what the other two had said, so he prayed to God saying, "Please, God, give me the strength and the tools and the intelligence to cross this river." And poof, God turned him into a woman. She looked at the map, hiked upstream 200 yards, and crossed the bridge. So I thought I'd encourage you ladies today. See, we're not always bad, are we? God is always faithful. Amen. Psalm 46, verse 10, just the first part of that verse. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. It doesn't mean to stop moving or to shut your mouth, but it has the meaning to relax, to let go of you trying to control circumstances. In our storm, we're not to try to control our situations, to make them to come out like the way we want them to turn out. He said, listen, you need to allow me to be involved in your life. It means to relax, to put your hands down to your sides, trust and believe that God will be involved and work in your trials. Be still and know that I am God. Now, how can we do that? Well, we know that God, he is a faithful God. The Bible states in Deuteronomy, he is God, the faithful God. It states in Isaiah 49, the Lord that is faithful. In 1 Thessalonians 5, faithful is he that calleth you. In Hebrews 10:23, he is faithful that promised. So God is faithful. As a matter of fact, God alone is 100% faithful 100% of the time. We live in a world of broken promises and half-truths. We don't know what to believe about COVID half the time, do we? This group says this group says this, then somebody else says something else about it. We don't know who's telling the truth when you listen to the politicians or you listen to the media. Even today, marriage vows don't mean a whole lot. People break them left and right. And so we see the broken promises and half-truths, but that's not the case with God. He states in Numbers 23:19, God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Hath he said, and shall he not do it? Or hath he spoken, and shall he not make it good? God's a faithful God. Titus 1:2 says, in hope of eternal life, which God that, what? Cannot lie. And so we have a God who doesn't lie, a God who says he will be faithful, and you can just write it down. I'm looking out, I'm seeing Hunter this morning. God's a faithful God, Hunter. You wouldn't be with us this morning if he weren't. So it's good to see you here this morning. Every word he says is true. The Hebrew word for true is the word emet. It means stability, certainty. You translate that into the English, it means true. It actually has the same meaning as amen. It is certain. It is absolutely true when he speaks. Everything God says and does is certain. His word is 100% reliable. God says what he means and means what he says. It's real simple. God never vacillates or falters. And as a result of that, you and I, we can stake our life, our souls, our plans, our storms upon what he says in his word and what he promises us. Isaiah 46:10-11 says, here he is declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure, calling a ravenous bird from the east, and the man that executeth my counsel from a far country. Yea, I have spoken it. I will also bring it to pass. I have purposed it. I will also do it. In other words, when he speaks, boom, it happens. Thank God that he's willing to do that. 2 Timothy 1:12, for the which cause I also suffer these things. I'm going through some trials. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Every word he says is true. Then every promise he's made will be kept. Every promise he says, and he will keep that promise. He says in 2 Corinthians there, for all the promises of God in him are yea, and in him amen, and to the glory of God by us. You can trust what he promises us. God's given us promises in his words that covers every circumstance of our life. 2 Peter 1:3, he says this, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. How? Through the knowledge, that's his word, of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. He's given us everything we need to know for our life in this book here called the Bible. We just need to study and know what he says. Amen? Philippians 1:6, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Hebrews 12:2, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. He starts it, he promises he will finish it. The work he has begun in you, he promises he will continue that work in you until the day you go home to be with him. That's his promise to you as a child of God. And when trials get hard, he says in 2 Corinthians 12:9, and he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. In other words, when you're going through it, if you just hold on to God, God's grace will be more than sufficient for you. Problem is, most people don't look to God, do they? They look to other things first. Usually, God's the last resort. Or he's not answering the way I think he should, so I just kind of forsake him and try to handle it myself. No, if you just stay faithful and you believe he's a faithful God, his grace will be sufficient for you. So, every word he says is true, every promise he's made will be kept, and every trial we face, he is there for us. States in 1 Corinthians 10:13, there hath no temptation trial taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it. God says it looks hopeless sometimes, but I want you to know something. I'll be faithful to you during that so that you'll be able to bear what you're going through. God's a good God. You and I, we all have trials, we have troubles. Some reasons we have these troubles, some are from our own doings. We reap what we sow. We can get ourselves in the biggest mess sometimes, can't we? I can't blame anybody else for the messes in my life that I've had except me. It's real simple. I reap what I sow. And then also from living in a fallen world. You and I, we live in a wicked, evil system, the God of this world. And since we're attached to this world, there are consequences at times, just because we're attached to it. And sometimes that causes us to go through trials. And then from attacks from Satan. Satan and his imps, they are real. They're not some mythology story. They are true. They are spirits, evil spirits of darkness. And they attack us at times. And then also from desertion of other believers, we have trials. It hurts. It states in 2 Timothy 4:10, Paul said, for Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed. How many times have you had a good Christian friend? And boy, they're coming to church, and they're trying to grow, and then all of a sudden you see them leave and go back out into the world. Anybody like that today? We've seen a lot of it, haven't we? And so sometimes they're your friends, and it's really disappointing when that happens. And then also from national disasters that we have. You know, we have the fires going on. We have the hurricanes going on. And then from the politicians. we could park here for the rest of the day. If I would speak about all of the politicians and their wanting control, taxes. This week we got a bill and they passed a tax on sewer water to the storm sewers. And our bill went from $79 a month to $479 a month. You believe that? I said, wait a minute. What's going on here? So we're going to check into it, but I'm sure we'll have to pay it. And they said, because we have a parking lot. And they're trying to do new work in the area and everything, I guess. But it's amazing what trials you go through sometimes. And then just from physical afflictions, our bodies are not glorified yet. Anybody ever noticed that yet? And so we have physical ailments, and we have hurts and pains and diseases and things like that. And then from losing of a loved one. It's awful when you lose a loved one. You love them. And the greatest thing, though, is to be a believer. Because it says, we are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. We know where our loved ones go if they're saved. And that guarantees one day happy reunion. We'll see them again one day. And what a hope that we have in Christ. And then trials come from our own testimony for Christ. Sometimes just because we're light, we're salt, because we're different than the world. We don't participate with some of the sins of the world. And so we kind of rub them wrong at some times. And we stand up for Christ at times. And as a result of that, we suffer. It states in 2 Timothy 3:12, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. And so when you stand up for Christ, you're going to get hit. And so just remember, though, these trials, these difficulties, they're mainly really not about us only, but they're about God. And God says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to relax. I want you to let go of trying to take charge of your own life. And during this storm, I want you to stop and think about me. And I want you to get to know me more intimately in the midst of this storm. I want you to trust me. It states in Psalm 34:19, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all. It states in 2 Timothy 4:16, at my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray, God, that it may not be laid to their charge. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, and that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that all Gentiles might hear, and so on and so on. And so Paul says, listen, sometimes even your friends don't stand up with you. But there's one person who won't ever forsake you. And he'll always stand up with you. And that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? God is so faithful. And he even uses these trials, these troubles that come in our life to show us some things. For instance, trouble shows us our frailty. Too often we get kind of puffed up and self-sufficient. And we forget God the way we should be thinking about him. You know, that's what he said to the Israelites in Deuteronomy 28. He said, listen, I'm going to bless you beyond measure. He said, but here's my fear. I'm fear that you're going to be so blessed, then you're going to be thinking you got that blessing yourself, and you will forget me. And I said, that's America. We've been blessed so much. We have so much than other countries ever thought about having. And yet we gripe, we complain. Or we just go along with the world and we forget God as being the priority, being the first love of all of us. Amen? Now, I told you before but about the fella. He was bitten by a rattlesnake and he was in the hospital. The pastor went up to visit him. He said, oh, pastor, pray for me. Please pray for me. And I'll be safe and I promise I'll start coming to church and reading my Bible. I'll start being a better Christian. Just pray for me. And the pastor prayed for him that he would be okay. Well, the guy got better. Pastor revisited him. He said, how are you feeling? He said, oh, I feel great now. He said, well, I haven't seen you at church yet. The guy said, you know, well, I got busy and I got something. And the pastor said, well, I understand. Before I leave, let's pray again. And he bowed his head and he said, God, send some more rattlesnakes. Amen. So he won't forget. So God, what he does in our troubles, he sends or permits a trial to invade our life, to get our attention, to humble us in our weaknesses. And it's sort of like God said, hey, remember me? Do you remember me? Lean up on me. Know that I'm the God of faithfulness. You can't do it alone. So I want you to somewhat relax and trust in my faithfulness. Let me show you what God can do. You know, Jesus Christ, he says this, I'm the one who makes God visible to man and visible as man. I'm the one who was with God at creation and who was the God of creation. I'm the one by whom and for whom and through whom everything was created. I'm the one who hung the stars in space and sustains the universe today. I'm the one who formed man and breathed my own life into him. I'm the creator, the living word, the long-awaited Messiah, the Jehovah God of the Old Testament, the Redeemer of Israel, the Savior of the world, the Son, the only begotten Son of God, the head of the body. That's who I am. That's why you can trust in me. The Pharisees couldn't stand him, but found they couldn't stop him. Satan tried to tempt him, but found he couldn't trip him. Pilate placed him on trial, but found no fault in him. The Romans crucified him, but couldn't take his life until he gave it. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. Amen. He's indestructible, indescribable, incomprehensible, inescapable, invincible, irresistible, and he's irrefutable. That's who God is. He says, listen, know me so you can trust me. We might be frail, but he's not frail. Amen. And troubles show our frailty. And then also troubles help us to have a better relationship or intimacy with God. David, when he was in trouble, he repented and he said, return unto me the joy of thy salvation. He lost that relationship, that intimacy with God. And if you're a Christian, you know what I'm talking about. When you're clicking on all cylinders, when things are right between you and God, there's a spiritual union of oneness, of closeness with Almighty God, isn't there? Then trouble reveals God's grace to us. He says, my grace is sufficient. I've experienced that grace in my life. Over a lot of lost and things in our life. And I've seen this grace work in a lot of other people's lives. Just this past week, I went by and saw Bob Schlottel. And Bob's been really fighting for his life. And he's gone through so much the last several weeks, for a long time. You don't know how much this guy has fought. And he's still here. And when I left, he said, I'm going to make it through this. He was still positive, still trusting God. And I said, that's the grace of God. And it reveals God's grace. Trouble also reproduces Christ within us. It helps us to be more like Christ. Philippians 3:10 says this, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings be made comfortable unto his death. Paul is saying, listen, I want to know the power that raised up Christ from the dead. I want to know that working in my life. And it comes as you surrender to the Lord. Why do all these things happen to us? Romans 8:29 says, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be, what? Conformed to the image of his son. The reason a lot of these things come into life, they're molding us. They're rubbing off the rough edges. He's creating you a vessel to honor. And he's working in your life. And then trouble releases us to greater service. You know, to be a leader, the Bible says, not a novice. In other words, you need to be more matured, tested, and tried. Abraham's our example. He had 25 tests, 25, and he passed them all. And after he passed those 25 tests, God gave him his greatest test. I want you to take your son, Isaac, take him up on that mount and offer him as a sacrifice for me. And Abraham was obedient. God had another plan up there, but he was obedient. He passed the test. Now, he was rewarded for believing in the faithfulness of God. God, one day later on, says, my friend, Abraham. Later on, he says, there's none other like Abraham. Abraham became the father of faith to Israel and to the body of Christ. And then think about Job. You think you have troubles. Can you remember Job? Everything he went through, his troubles, he lost everything. And he didn't know behind the scenes there was a battle between God and Satan working in his life, and God had confidence in Job. And Job stayed faithful to God because he trusted in God's faithfulness. As a result of that, he was rewarded. He had twice as much at the end of his life than he did in what he lost. Isn't that amazing? And these guys, they're favored in Scripture. People watch us in our trouble to see not just how we will respond in our trouble. That's part of it. They do observe that. But also to see if our God is faithful to us in our trouble. Did you get that last part? You see, in our troubles, it's our opportunity and responsibility to relax, to let God move in our time of storm and trouble, so that his faithfulness to us might impact those people that are observing us. 1 Thessalonians 3:3 says this, that no man should be moved by these afflictions, for yourselves know that we are appointed thereunto. We will have these times in our life. There's been times in my life where I've been touched by observing somebody. I remember when I was a student at Tennessee Temple, back in 74, covered wagon days. And I remember, though, had a student sit close by to me, and the security guard came over, said something to him, he got up and he left. And then the teacher told us that his little child, little son, had got something wrapped around his neck and strangled himself to death. 4 days later, after they had the funeral, he was right there in his spot. And that showed me the grace of God and the faithfulness of God that created faithfulness in him. And that touched me. I've never forgotten that. And so you don't know who's watching and observing you, do you? You don't know how God's going to use you to touch somebody else. And I just believe that God wants to. David gives us the faithfulness of God in a believer's life. For instance, Psalm 119, verse 67. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I have kept thy word. There, God's faithfulness intervenes when we stray away from him. Don't you know that God has our number, and he can send us a message of pain or trouble to arouse us to get back in relationship with him? Tim Lee said he was running from God, so God let him step on a landmine in Vietnam and took his legs off. He said, while I was laying there, I said, God, if I survive this, I promise I won't run anymore. I'll be a preacher. And boy, he became a great evangelist. I think David, when David, at the height of his sin, God sent an old preacher and says, thou art the man. And it changed David's life. David repented, got right, and God blessed him for getting right. And then also notice Psalm 119, verse 71. It is good for me that I have been afflicted. I've had trouble, okay? that I might learn thy statutes, or learn thy word. In our trials and troubles, we can learn more about God and his word. You see, sometimes it's not until we go through our dark valleys and difficult experiences do we truly get to know and realize how faithful our God is. In our trouble, it's interesting. When you say, okay, God, your will be done. I'm going to trust you in this. I'm going to trust in your faithfulness. And when you do that, there is a transition that takes place. There's a change that takes place from God, help me, deliver me from this trouble, to because of the trouble, I've been on my face before God, and all of a sudden I begin to realize the intimacy I am now having with God, that I say, thank you, God, for your faithfulness, and thank you for allowing me to go through this to draw me closer to you. Amen. My only hope is, God, is that when it's all over, I can stand up and say, my God has been faithful. Amen. So he says, relax, stop trying to control it. Let him do some work. Philippians 2:13 says this, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. God's working in you. I skipped over a couple things, fellas, on purpose. 1 Thessalonians 5:24, I love this verse. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. When he saves you, he doesn't just stop with you. He just continues on working his will out for your life. And I've learned that other people stand in awe. They're moved when they see believers' faith that rely on the faithfulness of God. And what it does, it convicts them to want to also believe in God. When they see your faithfulness and the faithfulness of God to you, they want this God. Huh? I think of Stephen. Stephen was being stoned, but he was being faithful because he had faith in the faithfulness of God, even if God called for his life at that moment. And the interesting thing about that was, when he died, there was a man standing by the name of Saul of Tarsus, and God used that as pricks in his side to convict him when he would visit him a little bit later. You don't know how God's going to use you in somebody else's life. So are you in a difficulty, trouble right now? Are you struggling to keep your faith and make sense of it? I just say to you, like the scripture, hold on to God. Don't look at your faith. Look at God's faithfulness to you. Amen? Look to that. We've all had our troubles. We've all been hit. We've all been wounded. We've all had trouble with something. And God says this in 1 Peter 5, and I'm closing. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Then verse 10, but the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that you have suffered a while, make you perfect or matured, establish, strengthen, settle you. See, God has a purpose in everything that we go through if you only lean upon God. He's a faithful God, people. Amen? I've asked Rachel to come and sing a song for us to close us out. And I want you to listen to the words of this song.
In my moments of fear, through every pain, every tear, there's a God who's been faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, when my heart had no song, still in love, he's proved faithful to me. every word he's promised is true. What I thought was impossible, I've seen my God do. He's and mercy I see. Though in my heart I have questioned, failed to believe, yet he's been faithful, faithful to me. Away the many times I could not pray, still my God, he was faithful to me. The days I spent so selfishly reaching out for what pleased me, God was faithful to me. Every time I come back to him, he is waiting with open arms, and I see once again love and mercy I see. Though in my heart I have questioned, even failed to believe, he's been faithful, faithful,
faithful,
faithful. Oh, so faithful to me.
Amen. Amen. Father, we come to you now. We just thank you for being such a faithful God. And Lord, in this world that we're living and everything's chaotic and hectic, crises everywhere we see, there's one stability that always stays the same, and that's you. And we're grateful for that. We know you're there. We know you're faithful. And may today we be still and know that you're God. You're the great God, the only one who can save, the only one that can help us in the time of our need, the only one who walks with us every day of our life. May we not forget you by the world's temptations and allurements, but may we stay faithful, close to you in our relationship. through prayer, through the Word of God, and through fellowship of other Christians. Thank you for that. And Lord, if there's somebody here this morning who's never been saved, I just pray that they would understand they don't have this available to them until they get saved. Then you're there for them at all time. So I just pray that they'd come up, say something to me, that they would like to be saved, and we'd praise your name for that. For those Christians that are going through some difficulties right now, encourage their hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You have a wonderful day. We love you.
We hope that you received a blessing from today's broadcast. We would love to have you to visit us in person. You can watch us live and view past services on our website at gpindy.net. For more information, please visit our website or contact us by phone. Until next week, may God richly bless you is our prayer.